Hello, and welcome to another edition of Coffee with Comrades, a podcast discussing current events, theory, and action through a radical lens. What's up, gang? Pearson here, right back at it again with your weekly dosage of Coffee with Comrades. This week, I got to sit down for a whirlwind conversation with Scott Crow, anarchist, author, purveyor of fine records, and longtime community organizer. We chat about Scott's radicalization, compassionate self-critique, the shortcomings of mass movement-centric forms of organizing, media and perception, and so much more. Before we get to today's discussion, check out this jingle from the Channel Zero Spotlight of the Month, Primal Anarchy.
You were born a hunter-gatherer. You were born a social animal, one that moves within the land and moves between bands in a world that was meant to be less measured, less exact. We were meant for lives with more meaning and less consequence, a life where connection and meaning are implicit, where animals have voices and trees have stories, a world where rivers flow unabated and water isn't a health hazard, a world without fences, a world without flags, a world without rulers and gods. It's our world. The world of primal anarchy.
We are here to say that either the world burns or the cities do. We're here to say that abusers convince you that you have no choice. We're here to say that marketers convince you that you have their options. We're here to say that you are wild, that you can be free. We're here to say that there's a match in one end and bull cutters in the other. And we aren't here to say that the world is waiting. We are here to say that the world is fighting. We are here to say that their story only ends one way. And we're here to tell you that there are others.
Primal Anarchy Podcast is a collection of rants, tirades, condemnations, readings, musings, explorations, response, interviews, and iterations hosted by Primal Anarchist writers Kevin and Natasha Tucker.
Find us online at primalanarchy.org, all major podcast platforms, and the Channel Zero Anarchist Podcast Network.
You can check out Kevin and Natasha's episodes wherever you get your podcasts. Coffee with Comrades is proud to be a member of the Channel Zero Network and the Rev Left Radio Federation. If you dig this program, please consider signing up to become a monthly sustainer of Coffee with Comrades by going to www.patreon.com/coffeewithcomrades. For as little as a dollar a month, you can help keep Coffee with Comrades afloat for years to come and get some sweet perks like an invitation to our Discord server, exclusive first access to new episodes, stickers, bonus contents, zines, and so much more. And listen, if money is tight, we totally get it. You can still support the program by telling your friends about this podcast, rating and reviewing the show on Apple Podcasts or the Google Play Store, or linking up with us on Twitter and Instagram so you never miss a new episode. With all that said, please enjoy episode 86 of Coffee with Comrades, Tilting at Windmills, featuring Scott Crow.
Better for each other. We call it mutual aid. The ideas of direct action, that we don't have to wait on others, that we are more than voters, we are more than consumers. There are other powers that we should take, and we don't need to wait on others to do it. We do it ourselves, and we do it in our community. The ideas of collective innovation, that we're all tied in this together, that I don't want to be better on the back of somebody else, but I don't want somebody to be better on the back of somebody else. And this idea has over 100-year tradition of libertarianism, where it's better for all of us. And it's also really happiness. And I think that that's a really important.
This week, I have the pleasure of sitting down with author and purveyor of fine records, Scott Crow. Welcome on Coffee with Comrades, Scott.
Hey, I'm glad to be on here. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, of course. Listen, I am super glad that we could finally find some time to sit down and chat because I've been wanting to connect with you for a while now, have you on the program. So I'm honestly am to have this conversation with you. Before we get into it, would you mind introducing yourself to listeners who may not be aware of you and your work?
Wow, that's always a hard question. I've had many hats. I'm a longtime community organizer. I've been an anarchist for 20-something years. I've been a small business owner. I worked in the green economy at a recycling center, driving a forklift for a long time. I've owned, in the past, I've owned art galleries, fine furniture, antique, mid-century modern stores. So it's been quite a few hats. And as of late, I've just been running, I started a record label last fall called emergencyhearts.com. And I write books a lot, and I guess I've been a speaker too. I don't know. It's always hard to fucking do that. I just do things. I just do whatever piques my curiosity about something, or if something I think that I want to work on and solving problems. So that's my two. Those have been my two approaches to things. And so within that, it's just I've had a lot of stuff, but a lot of it has been centered in the last 30 years around politics in some form or another. And first inside the system for a long time, you know, starting in the 80s, and then outside of the system since the late 90s, when I just started to give up on electoral politics and just start working outside of those systems and finding other systems that I wanted to engage people with myself.
Yeah, totally. Well, I'm sure it's a story you've been asked many times, but like, what was that process like? You know, I like asking guests who come on the show how they sort of got into radical politics, how they got radicalized. And something tells me that between COVID-19 and our current financial crisis and the accelerating fallout of global climate change, a lot of folks are going to be getting into more radical politics here in the near future. And so I wanted to kind of ask, like, what was that journey like for you, kind of moving from one sphere, talking about being inside the system to being outside of it? What was that like?
Well, I think that there's been a few, you know, it's like in fits and starts. It's not like this evolution happened and this happened. It's like, you know, it's like things come and happen in my life that have affected me. But one of the earliest things was I grew up working class poor outside of Dallas, largely. And I was born to an unwed mother at the time in the 60s, which was very rare. And those things began to shape me a lot. And, you know, growing up in largely semi-rural area, growing up with people going to prison around me, my dad did 15 years, my uncles went to prison, my cousins went to prison. Drugs and alcohol were, you know, the dominant factors. So those things kind of shaped me. And also I think that mass culture, you know, definitely shaped me also in thinking about radical stuff. I mean, early PBS stuff, when they were showing Greenpeace stopping whaling in the 70s, had a huge and profound effect on me. I mean, I was like, I never saw people put their bodies on the line between a non-human animal and humans before, ever. And watching footage of that was dramatic. And I think that my mom also shaped me. She was always a radical. She's one of those kind of Texas women that's just like always kind of a square peg in a round hole or something. And so how she got that, I have no idea how she got that, but she's always been that kind of make her own way. But she grew up in extreme poverty, and so like dirt floor poor, and so she wanted better for me. So those things shape me. And then along the way, you know, just get exposed to stuff. I quit high school. I was gonna be the first person to graduate from high school in my whole family, my whole extended family. About sixth grade was about how most people went. So that affected me, like saying, hey, there's some world out there that I want to see that doesn't have anything to do with high school as I know it, was something that doesn't sound like that big of a step now, but it was a huge step at the time to go like, well, what is it I want? And start to ask myself that and not have any idea what to do and make that break. And I went to college for about a year, and I studied music there. And that's where I got exposed to like political organizing, community organizing through the South, the anti-apartheid movements in South Africa. And so I wasn't an organizer really, but that's where I started to fall into that kind of stuff. And I started to really think about animal liberation and animal rights sometime in around 86, 87. And I, uh, started to become vegetarian, but wasn't quite there. And then I was in bands at the time, and I was using music as a platform to talk about political things. And my band went on tour with this band called Skinny Puppy, and the tour was called the Vivisect Six Tour, which is all about animal vivisection. And so I really got exposed to the stories talking to them, but also the show itself. And then that was my exposure, kind of really a huge politicization started to come out of music. And so I'd been exposed to punk rock and new wave, and I'd come out of heavy metal being a musician ever since I was like 11 years old. But nothing made sense until I really kind of fell into industrial music. And when I fell into industrial music, it was super politicized. And so through bands like Ministry and Skinny Puppy and Consolidated and Meat Beat Manifesto, and I mean, there's a myriad of bands, I started to learn more about the world. In fact, actually, Al Jurgensen from Ministry was the first person I ever heard use the term working class. And I was like, that guy just described my life. I never even heard that term before. You know, was it some big academic or something? He's like, totally. You just talk about being blue collar and working class. And I was like, holy shit, that's my whole family. But you have to understand, there's no context. There's no fucking internet. You know, like you watch the families on TV and stuff, and you just they weren't the people that were around me. So I mean, that's kind of where all that stuff came out of. And so I became vegan and vegetarian for the next 30 something years because of that, and started working on animal liberation pretty seriously starting in 88. And then just, you know, but you know, like it's like, it's again, it's fits and starts. I mean, I'm writing letters, and I mean, I was writing letters against censorship in 1986 and 85 and stuff. When the PMRC, the Parents Music Resource Group, was really trying to put labeling on records and censor records and get them taken off shelves and stuff like that. So forgotten about cause now, but it was something I was part of. And it's just like, again, just these things, but mostly working within the system, right? Like letter writing and petitioning and voting and doing stuff. And so I worked within the Democratic parties, you know, like I was voting in early 90s and late 80s and stuff, and trying to get rights stuff legislation passed, and trying to get environmental stuff passed. I was given in organizations, but it wasn't that much. But I was raising a family at the time. I had a son, and like I was running an art gallery and stuff. And then I gave up on the Democratic Party because I just really, you know, really hated what they were doing. And so sometime in the mid 90s, I started voting Libertarian in Texas, even though I didn't even care about the platform that much, but I still was within those systems. So I started voting Libertarian quite a lot. I had been, you know, all during this time, that you have to understand that in the left in the United States, communism, big C communism and socialism dominated the left. And so like at every protest, it would be like these organizations with fucking myriad of names and all the splits they had over the last 30 years.
Alphabet soup
of radical politics. But they were always the ones who were organizing stuff. And I worked with a lot of socialists, a lot of ex-Panthers, a lot of Young Lords, Brown Berets that were in Dallas, where I was living at the time. And so I was, you know, that was like kind of what I thought I was, you know, like, and the only anarchists that had been exposed to had been in the mid to late 80s, early 90s. And they were, you know, they're mostly either punk rock or nihilist of some, not political nihilist, but, you know, just like the parody that you would look at for anarchy and stuff. And they were kind of assholes too. Like I didn't, you know, like they weren't engaging or anything. And so like, I just didn't really engage. And then, my last foray into electoral politics was in the late 90s, and I worked for the Ralph Nader campaign for getting him on the ballot. I actually was a paid person, like I was a paid staff person. They, you know, took my life to get him ballot access in Texas. And I really saw the last of the dirty politics with really like what parties like the Democratic Party were doing really to undermine anything that was happening outside of that. And this wasn't like I was trying to take a hard stand. I was like, why would y'all do this? Why would you try to undercut this? You know, 40 years of failures on the Democratic Party to address concerns of the people that they supposedly serve. And now you want to blame the failure of an election in 2000 on a third party candidate who just address those needs, who was never going to get elected anyway. I think it was a total failure of them on the outside. And then internally, it was way worse than that. They, you know, tried to stop us at every turn. They, you know, they reported. There's just a lot of fucking dirty shenanigans. Not even worth going into because the DNC is not even worth it. But that was it. That was the last time I was like my last foray into electoral politics. And that was 2000. I voted for Ralph Nader, and that was the first person I ever voted for in my whole life that I was really excited about. Even though I knew he wasn't going to win, I just liked it. And then that was it. And I was like, I'd already been having this dual life because the Green Party was the last foray because it had this direct action wing. I would say that loosely, quote unquote. It was really just an action wing of protests and doing this stuff, but at the same time I was trying to work on electoral politics, and I thought that was a neat dual power strategy. Of course, that's not really what the Green Party ended up doing at all. It was all about electoral politics, and the rest of the shit got thrown aside. So I left that kind of disillusioned. And then but sometime along in the late 90s, I'd gotten exposed to anarchism in a more adult way through this wobbly adult organizer who worked in communities outside of his own. I worked with a lot of drug addicts, ex-drug addicts, and alcoholics, and did just a lot of super street organizing. And I met him in 98. We started getting exposed to very adult versions of anarchism. But it's funny because you can't think about this now. This is probably a reason weirdly to think about. But into the late 90s and early 2000s, most of the books on anarchism were from the 60s. There was very few books on contemporary forms of anarchy. I mean, we've been in an anarchy renaissance since 2000 now, where there's thousands of books in English now. But there was a time when there was nothing. I mean, really, literally, like you could hardly find any contemporary books on it. You know, there's a few people like Bookchin and people that were putting out books, but hardly anybody. It was really weird. It was a weird, vacuous time. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I learned from that. And so that's just kind of been engaged. And the litany of groups I've worked with is long. I worked for Greenpeace on the direct actions teams for 10 years. I worked for Rainforest Action Network for 5 years on their actions teams. I worked for Ruckus Society for 8 years on their actions teams. And again, I didn't do any campaigning. All I did was actions. So I either organized or participated in actions as a paid person, went around the country doing stuff. And lots of people do that. And I worked with a ton of, and I started a ton of nonprofits, and I started an art co-op in 19, the first cooperative I ever started was with a band. When you start working with, other band members, that's a cooperative.
Totally.
A collective for a long time. So I'd been doing that for a long time. Then I opened an art gallery in 1995 called Red Square. It was a play on of Red Square in Moscow, but also, like Mondrian paintings and stuff. And then that gallery closed in 96 because art's hard to sell. And then in 97, I started a shop called Century Modern. And that was run as a cooperative with five other people. And we ran that business. I sold it in 2001. But again, I started organizing out of the shop and used the funds from it to organize things at the same time. So it was kind of interesting piece to do. And then after that, I just left. When I sold my part, I just worked for nonprofits over the time doing actions and stuff for many years. And at the same time, just kept forming organization after organization. One, to learning stuff along the way and realizing what it is I want to do. And, as part of the mobilization for global justice. But you have to understand that, like, I've had so many different sections of my life that sometimes I just close the chapter on them and forget them for a long time, and then I come back to them. I have to reassess them. And I've been in a reassessment phase lately, when this podcast during the pandemic will come out, of my earlier music life that I had closed the chapter on in 92 and just kind of forgotten about for a long time, but have reengaged with. And so even what I've been talking about now with politics, that earlier politics has been kind of similar, even though I talk about some of the stuff in Black Flags and Windmills, I still didn't even go into all the details of it, all my regrets, all the lessons learned and stuff. There's just so much you can fucking write about. But you have to remember, it's not linear. It's not like I did this and then I did this and then did this. It's fucking all at the same time. It's messy.
Well, I think that that's what's so interesting too about like life and about people's kind of paths towards like radical politics is that they are so rarely linear. It's not like a one-off event. It's a thing that continually is shaped and then reshaped and then renavigated and reformed. And it's people who get into this type of politic who are deeply concerned about the earth and about all of its inhabitants, both human and non-human alike, become invested in this like particular form of praxis and theory because of the fact that it's complicated and convoluted, and I think secretly like we're all just like super nerds and love like thinking through and grappling with all of this shit and trying to make sense of it. And I don't think any of us have, like, you know, it's almost trite to say, well, none of us have the answers, but I think like that is kind of a truism in many ways, that like, you know, talking about it and wrestling with it and struggling with it is part of trying to find something that might approximate an answer.
Oh man, I totally agree with you. But in what you're saying in that, like, I did have all the answers though, and I think most people do think that they have the answers, and that is problematic. We wouldn't even have this conversation 20 years ago, probably. Really, like maybe like over coffee or something, you know. But like to publicly be able to go to say, oh, I made mistakes on that is a very new phenomena, and especially within activist circles and anarchist circles, where being right is often more important than doing the right thing. So I have wrestled with that a long time. The other thing is, I've been doing it long enough. I'm about 35 years into the fucking political world, where I've made enough mistakes and I realize that there's unintended outcomes, consequences, and impacts on everything that you think is right. Right. Does that make sense?
No, totally.
So, and so I've actually got to see things, and I'm sorry that I put some things in. You know, like, I was one of the people, not, it wasn't me personally, but like me as working within activist circles or whatever politic I was in, that we put things forward that I was like, I'm sorry that happened, because I'm really sorry the way that came out, really, you know, like, did, that's not the, what we thought was going to happen at all. You know, like, for example, like when I was, you know, first delving into animal rights and animal liberation stuff, I mean, I wanted vegan everything, everywhere, all the time. I wanted McDonald's and corporations to sell vegan burgers and stuff. But later I realized I didn't want McDonald's to exist. It didn't need to exist. Not even just for animal rights. Does that mean, you know what I'm saying?
No, totally. Because it's a like blight of capitalist excess. Absolutely.
Yeah. And like, you know, like with food in particular, like, I never thought that I wanted vegetable oil because I didn't want more animals killed from it. But what happened was they came up with hydrogenated vegetable oil, and it turns out vegetable oil is really, really bad for us when cooked at high heat, which is pretty much all processed foods. And I'm against it. Like, that's not what I thought would happen. That's not the way I wanted it to go. And so I'm sorry. And I'm sorry. And I didn't realize that veganism was going to become a fucking, well, one, a cult, a religious cult, and then two, on one hand, just another mass consumer capitalism.
Like, lifestyle,
you know, capitalism appropriates it appropriates everything, you know, as you know, right?
Totally, yeah.
And so, you know, veganism became this whole, it just became another fucking dietary fad that they could just make a fucking shit ton of money on the same basic ingredients over and over again, And I didn't want that to happen. So again, those are silly examples, but those are some examples of like unintended outcomes, consequences, and impacts that like were set in motion by myself and, you know, many other people decades ago that I wish had not happened. But that list is long. We're just scratching the surface on that list.
Well, I mean, it's like Beckett said, you know, like, try again, fail better. And I think that, like, you're right. I think that the recent resurgence of self-criticism and the honesty and the transparency and the humility that it, like, requires to do self-criticism is like a really welcome thing, because you're absolutely right. Like, people are so fucking afraid, Scott, of being wrong, that they will cling to whatever vestige of righteousness that they can grasp. And I think that, you know, we gotta shed that that hubris and find ways to, you know, turn the ruthless, you know, critique of all that exists upon ourselves as well, and possess the, you know, the humbleness to move forward and to try and learn from what we've done, both for good and for ill. and be better the next time.
I mean, I agree about self-critique is a good, important thing, but in the way that in my interpretation of the crossing ball, the activist subculture for the last 35 years in different worlds, is that. So when I started, self-critique came out of the Maoist and the communist traditions, right? The critique, self-critique, and those were fucking terrible. They were fucking terrible sessions. And when they stopped doing it, I never had to go to one, but I would, I would see them happening. It sounded like religious babble to me is what it fucking sounded like. And then when I really fell in with anarchists, there wasn't really so much. They didn't, we rejected those models, right? Even though we were red and black because all the other stripes hadn't really come to the forefront in the United States. Red and black, we still had many communist people within anarchist circles. But then there started this whole thing of, I don't know. It's always been there, this high moralism within activist subculture. And that critique and self-critique is not what I'm talking about at all. The one where you have to point somebody down so that you can be right, or where every little transgression or micro transgression or mistake is amplified to knock that person down. That is fucking worthless. Totally fucking worthless. And that's what the Maoists, what I watch them fucking do with each other. And then that's what I see people doing now. I call it eating our own. And there's just no reason for it. What I am trying to engage in is a new kind of, not that I'm not making it up, but I'm trying a different kind of way of saying, well, hey, look, these ideas could have relevance and importance, and they also might be right about some things, but they're wrong about a lot of things that I don't even understand yet. But what if we start down this road, but we reevaluate them over and over again, not pointing fingers and wagging our fucking fingers at each other or ourselves, but saying, I'm willing to try this. And it's a totally different arrangement. If you only have groups of people who, as you mentioned way earlier at the top of the show, like lots of people are coming in. This is what always happens. Thousands of people have come in. Like in the time I've been here in the political movements, I've seen tens of thousands of people come through. Ask me how many people of those are around. I would tell you that handfuls. And by the time you get to be my age, most people have left political subcultural movements altogether. And unless they're fucked up or angry or have unresolved shit or immature or whatever the things are, I don't know what it is, but they become hardened and bitter generally. And it's really weird, but movements just don't retain people. So when you have movements and subcultures that are largely based on these first two, where people who are rejecting everything and trying to figure out who they are, well, it's hard to have critique and self-critique. Because it doesn't allow a very good developmental space in it, because people are insecure about who they are within those movements and those subcultures, and they don't get a lot of support in that growth and development. And if they do, they probably leave the movements. So anyway, that's a piece I have in there about this. And so when I talk about being open and sorry and talk about unintended outcomes, consequences, and impacts of things, and also being self-critiquing to myself, I do it from a place of love and kindness and respect of myself, not from finger wagging, which is what I used to tell myself. If somebody wasn't wagging their finger at me or I wasn't wagging my finger at them, I was wagging it at myself within these subcultures. And it wasn't an anomaly. It wasn't just like I was the only person doing it. There's a whole subculture that reinforces it over and over again, which is why I left activist subculture. It just took me 30 something years to do it. But I finally realized I didn't like that. And after being out of it, at activist subculture now for almost 5 years, like I'm talking about when I, and you haven't asked me, but I'm like, activist subculture, what is that? Meetings, only organizing, going to protests, the few little institutional spaces that we have created that, that we have where people would gather, whether they're community spaces or prisoner riding places or whatever, these little spaces that we have carved out, it's those spaces. That's where this takes place. And I'm not saying amongst individuals necessarily, but amongst a subculture of people. And so, So with that, I think that there's always difficulty in growing. That's why we always have to come back to 101 trainings with everything all the time. Because by the time you get to 104 trainings or 204, or whatever, I don't know academic shit, but, you know, but it's like, but by the time you get up there, it's like those people are gone already.
It is interesting, though, thinking about like the limitations and the ramifications of when things become subcultures and how, when they become insular and when they be like sort of become inoculated and shielded from, you know, healthy, you know, compassionate and loving critique, what can happen to them. And so I do want to talk about that and explore that a little bit with you. But first, I wanted to kind of talk about mutual aid a bit with you. Recently, there's been a lot of discourse regarding mutual aid, which is why I finally had an excuse to invite you on the program. And by discourse, I really just mean disingenuous shit slinging and naysaying on the internet. Social Democrats, liberals, progressives who sort of put all their eggs into the basket of electoralism. And now that it's, you know, crashed and burned because of repeated sabotage and collusion between, you know, the ruling class and corporate media, these folks just kind of throw in the towel and adopt this kind of fatalistic nihilism that seems to say, well, you know, this was our only chance of generating social change, and the mass movement is the only way to create and generate a revolutionary rupture in society. And I want to be fair, because like the argument I think is an interesting one, even if it's ineffectual and ultimately unhelpful. The basic argument seems to say that, like, you know, mutual aid efforts are a retreat from mass movement building. And so I'm curious, because I know at the top of the episode, you and I were talking a little bit about like the limitations of mass movement building. And I'm curious, like, you know, if it's not mass movements that sort of change history, then what would you like kind of say is the sort of engine that is, you know, making history change in a way that leads us towards greater and greater degrees of autonomy and liberation?
Oh man, there's so many things in all of what you just talked about. But just leading with the very last question is, mass movements are totally, absolutely ineffective anymore. They have no place anymore. They actually are great inoculators, I guess, of bringing people in for a sense of sense of camaraderie. There's limited value in that, right? But since 1999, specifically in the United States, and I would say in many parts of the world, where anarchy has taken root, is that it's largely rendered the old models and paradigms irrelevant. Instead of movements, you know, mass movements, it's movements of movements now. And the way I always envision it, and this is the way, like, history, because your question was like, how does history change culturally? That's how it changes. It's not by fucking mass movements. It just culturally changes. Sometimes it's rapid and fits and starts, and sometimes it takes 20 and 30 years for stuff to take root. Most of the time it takes 20 or 30 years for stuff to take root if you look at it. There's an actual whole there's a whole diagram for it in social psychology. I can't even remember what it's fucking called. Oh, it's like innovation diagram or something that shows you how this happens. But for me, I look at mass movements as dead ends. Mass movement is a dead end. Big tent philosophies are dead ends. They are fucking totally dead ends. And the reason that they're dead ends is because, not because they don't have some value, like I said, like I mentioned before, in bringing people in and doing things, is that it brings in people at the lowest common denominators of values and commonalities. So extreme examples you'd see is like what's happening in Germany right now around the pandemic. There's protests there like there has been in the United States, where people are saying lift the restrictions and fascism's coming and stuff. Well, the people who are organizing the protests are two anti-capitalist liberals who have long track record of writing, you know, anarchist kind of tracks and publishing leftist material and stuff, but that's not who's showing up at their big tent events. It's a lot of Nazis, right-wing guys, conspiracy theorists and stuff, because, and they don't care, because in the larger mass movement, they're gaining numbers and they're getting to influence people. And so this is what we always tell ourselves, right? So, but it never happens because one, you end up squabbling with people over minor details about ethics and values. What do you value? So if I have 10 values and you have 10 values, but we only agree on two or three, well, instead of forming a mass movement that we're going to fight over power and prestige and influence and who's right and all these things, what if we just have movements of movements, which is what led me to anarchy, which is like, I'll take my 10 values and find other people who have these 10 values and I'll begin to work on them. And then you take your 10 values and you go with your people and you work on them. And then where we cross over, we just have, you know, tactical alliances occasionally. I'm not saying with right wing and militia and stuff like that, but in the extreme case I was giving earlier, but even people amongst liberal subsets or radical subsets or progressive subsets or whatever. I mean, I would organize with right wingers, you know, a right winger who's not a Trump supporter, you know. I mean, I would do that. If somebody has values, they have values. I don't give a fuck what their politics are. We can only have those minutiae of conversations when it's easy. But when the fucking rubber meets the road and there's danger or we're in a disaster, those minutiae float away. But I still have to recognize I am still who I am, or I still have the values I have, and I'm not going to give them away. Like, you can't be a crazy racist, you know, want to murder people. And I'm just going to turn a blind eye because we're feeding hungry people here right now or whatever it is, right? If I don't know about it, of course I'm going to turn a blind eye because I don't know about it. But you know what I'm saying? So it creates strange bedfellows. So mass movement as an idea is a total dead end. And in the electoral, I'm going to touch on electoral politics just for a second and abstracts, but The DNC and the Democrats, who would supposedly represent all the marginalized voices in the United States, which we know that is not true in any form, in any capacity, have not, whatever the dream is that we have about them, about Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy and the Kennedys and stuff in the 60s. Well, one, it's manufactured, but two, it's a fucking paradigm that just does not exist and didn't really exist. I'm not trying to get into history, but just didn't exist and definitely doesn't exist now. And mass movements had a time and a place where you could, when there was nowhere else for you to make your voice heard or to know other people are out there. But now, because of the internet and the way that we use it, there's just no need for it anymore. And it doesn't work. It just waters down everything. So in the 90s, we started to promote the idea of movement of movements. And that's where anarchists were able to actually break the stranglehold of electoral politics and all party politics upon street protests and mass organizing. And we began to organize what we called coalitions, but we're often just strategic alliances. Like, we agree with you on this particular thing about neoliberalism, and so we will work with these particular groups on this for this particular period of time. And so that is where I still am at today. If I was going to organize things with somebody, I would go like, okay, here's your values. They're not crazy, you know, way outside of mine. Here's my values. All right, we can get together on this because this is where we really agree on these things, that, and it's important. And disasters, again, like I mentioned earlier, bring that to the forefront. And so look at it like this, because I talked about the analogy, which I never gave earlier, which is that it's like waves coming to the shore. The shore is the future. That's the thing that we're reaching towards. But instead of one giant wave coming to the shore and then receding back, movements are just constantly waves just coming to the shore and moving back, and they cross and overlap, and they are way down the shoreline in different directions and stuff. But that, to me, is a good analogy of it. If you just see the water coming up and then it recedes, and then other movements are coming and doing things, and that way people, this is how you start to get towards autonomous, networked, smaller movements that are much more accountable to each other, to the communities that they supposedly serve, and to each other. And I think that there's limits in building this, but I believe believe that our futures as climate change and the disasters that we have, political, economic, and war, are going to continue at a scale and at a network scale that we haven't seen before, that we're going to need more resiliency and autonomy and network communities to do this. How it all takes place, like the actual building of it, man, that's up to you to fucking do. You know, that's not my job to tell you how to do it. I can tell you how some foundational ideas. I think that if we agree, if you agree with them, that we that are good to build from. But that's about all I can do. And so that's where I've gotten to, is about recognizing that I'm very curious about solving problems, and I think that people should approach them from curiosity, as well as the great desire and need to alleviate suffering in the world, but also with a fucking humbleness that I don't have the answers, but I'm willing to try this, and if it doesn't work, I'll go down this other path. The question you would ask, I would think, would be like, well, give me a reference for this. I would say, look at the Zapatistas.
I was just about to ask, you literally stole the words out of my mouth. I was going to say, you know, the idea of the Zapatistas, a world where many worlds fit, the sort of decentralization, you know, movement of movements. That it sounds exactly like what you're talking about.
Of course. And you have to understand that though the Zapatistas really, for me, were a huge entree world into anarchy and a huge influence on the anarchist movements in the 90s up in the early 2000s. But even though they never said we're anarchists or we're socialists or whatever, but those ideas have carried forward. But the biggest piece in this conversation that we're having is that one part, which is that we'll try this and we don't know if we're right. It's working for us, but if it's not working, we're going to try something else for our people, and we're going to keep doing it. And so, I mean, there's a myriad of other things within Zapatismo ideas that, you know, are also there, but that particular piece, I think, is really illuminating, I guess I would say.
Yeah, for sure. Well, speaking of the Zapatistas, I want to pivot now to kind of questions of community armed self-defense, which I know you've written about and thought about pretty extensively. And it's been kind of wild with COVID-19 because it's really brought the eco-fascists out of the woodwork. You know, there are increasingly stronger and stronger links between the far right and the more sort of mainstream right, and it's becoming more and more overt and less subtle. The dog whistles are becoming screams. They're saying the quiet parts loud. And I wanted to ask you a little bit about the most recent string of protests that we've started to see at state capitol buildings featuring armed right-wingers who want to liberate people from COVID-19 stay-at-home orders. You even have, you know, Donald Trump, trumpeting on about how these liberation protests are good. And it seems pretty clear to me that the far right militia movement is basically using every tactic in its playbook to kickstart a violent kind of far right insurgency. And so I was just curious, like, you know, what are some of your general thoughts on these developments and how people who actually care about liberation, how do you think we ought to respond?
This is my angle on this. It has nothing to do with guns whatsoever. So I'm going to talk about media and perception. When I hear you say some of the statements you made, like there's connections to the far right and right wing politicians and stuff like there had never been before, that everybody, I know you're just speaking shorthand, so I'm not even trying to parse words. Just follow me for a second. That all the internet trolls and all these people are doing this particular thing. There's all these protests. Okay, in my perception, all of that is fucking tiny. It seems magnified depending on what internet filter bubble I look at for it. But 100 people gathered around in any particular town across the country is fucking tiny. And right wingers have always had that kind of problems. I don't see it as a big thing. The thing that is to me, from about perception and media, that is, there's two big pieces that are far different than any time before. One is that you have a shit bag. We always have shit bags for presidents, to be honest. But there's a super shit bag who is actually a fucking imbecile in the White House in D.C. right now. That guy is he's an echo chamber to give it more perception than the reality is on the ground, on one hand. And two, he's amplified stuff that has never been able to amplify before. It just never could happen before. People like Alex Jones, the shitbag conspiracy fuckwad here in Texas, could never have the reach that the tiny-handed orange one has. And so there's a feedback loop that's going on with this particular president and this administration that's never happened before. He's not just a TV president. He's a manipulator, psychopathic, so he's using it. But the thing is, he has no filter for himself. So he reverberates this stuff and he has no idea about it, right? So that's one major container. The other container in this is, to me, is that what you have is unprecedented right-wing media that we never had before, with the rise of Fox News first, and then this whole right-wing media ecosystem around things like that, which, just like all media, all corporate media, all media, fuck it, you want to get eyeballs onto your thing, so you say the most extreme thing. So New York Times posts a story says, cat trapped in tree. Fox News says, Democrats cat stuck in tree. Then Alex Jones says lizard aliens put Democrat cat in tree to make the president look bad. That's not far enough. So then, Little Green Footballs has to say that the Democrats are trying to destroy America by letting this Democrat's cat be in the tree. Do you know what I'm saying? So this is a silly example, but this is totally true with what happens so that people can get their eyeballs on. I'm not even fucking trying to say Alex Jones isn't the one who has the worst stuff, but they have created an ecosystem and filter bubbles for media that some people never look outside of now. So, and because this dirtbag who is in the administration, that's the shitty administration that's always shitty, but is shittier now, they recognize it and they just keep feeding it. And so they are able to feed stuff that has just never happened before. We just have never seen this before. And I think that leftists and I think corporate mainstream media underestimates the power of those ecosystems generally. I'm not saying that people have it. There have been media critiques and stuff that have said, yeah, we should definitely look at this and stuff. But I'm telling you that in my fucking opinion of watching media and paying attention to media and how you can use it to have it and as a sphere of influence for the last 30 something years, I see an unprecedented ecosystem that just is self-perpetuating. And that is far more insidious and dangerous because not only is it perpetuate the stupid stories within themselves, but it also says, don't trust any other narratives outside of this ecosystem. Over and over again, it says that. And it's created distrust in this country, which when politics and culture is based on fear, it's really hard to make rational decisions from, or even open-hearted emotional decisions from. In fact, it's impossible to do because you're dealing with two sets of realities there. And the way the left, I'm using left in very broad quotes here, quote unquote left, coming back to the activist subculture and stuff and how this goes is that the whole mission is to prove people wrong because we are morally right. I'm not saying I am, but I'm saying that's the position we come from. So how, if we have one set of reality that's based on more mainstream culture, but we think that we are morally superior, how are we ever going to communicate with those groups who are totally in fear and are growing, but I wouldn't even say larger than they were in the early 90s or the mid 90s, right after Waco, just around Waco when Branch Davidians were killed by the FBI. That was a huge militia movement in the United States too. There was tens of thousands of people that were in it. And the Confederate Hammerskins and the skinhead movement. I was in Dallas when they started. I mean, that movement was huge. There was thousands of skinheads in the late 80s. So I don't know if there's more now. So I'm not trying to contradict everything that we just talked about, but I'm just trying to say that I think the perception is it's larger than it actually is. Because of the way media works, it's getting more eyeballs and more resonance outside of those bubbles than it normally would. And then you've got a shit. Yeah, exactly. It's getting super boosted, where shit was just like zines that they would circulate amongst the 400 of them or whatever it was. And the other thing that we always forget about extremist right-wing movements is that they are, everybody in those movements wants to be the boss. And they are, and I'm not, when I say right-wing movements, I'm not even, this happens with mainstream right-wing movements too, but definitely in the neo-Nazi, the eco-fascist stuff, everybody wants to be the leader of the group. So they're always self-destructing. And it's very, very common for the people to be incredibly disturbed people in different ways, you know, hence mass shootings, you know, feel like they're, you know, they're not getting the sex that they should be getting as a hetero white male and things like that. Like all of these things are magnified across many of these groups. And so they often just self-destruct. I mean, we watched Adam Waffen just totally self-destruct way before the FBI even jumped in on it and helped to, you know, to stop it. Or whatever they did, or set them up, you never can tell with the FBI, but you know, so, but I think that I always have to be careful, and when I think about, when I say all the trolls, or I think that there's a huge growing movement of these people, I have to be careful of what my perception of that is, because if I perceive that they are winning in that, I become afraid of it, and I'm like, hey, we got to do something about this, but when it's not really true.
And I think it's an interesting framing that you use, like the shift from thinking about like the spec, because it is a spectacle, right? It's the spectacle of, you know, far right dipshits wearing Hawaiian t-shirts talking about the boogaloo. You know, it gels well. It gets clicks, you know, it gets eyeballs on papers, it sells advertisements. And I think that framing is helpful, because it does sort of point to, you know, is this a threat? Yes. Is it as wide a threat as the corporate media would like us to believe? Probably not. And I think that is a sober assessment, and I think it's a useful one that we would do well to remember. I think that, you know, there are certain sectors on the left that very much want to cosplay as the Red Army, and I think that that's a very dangerous line of thinking.
I do too.
Especially when we look at like the current like limitations of the crisis that the far right kind of engenders with firearms. Yes, is it a legitimate threat? Yes, no mistake about it. Is it as wide a threat as we think? Probably not.
Right. I agree with all of that.
Or rather, is it as wide as a threat as we've been led to think? Because I think that's the crucial part of your point, right? Like we've been engendered to believe this.
Exactly. And it just depends on how you perceive it and where you look at it. You know, like that is the biggest thing, because like, you know, like you had mentioned, we were talking about mutual aid. You had said, hey, there's all these trolls and stuff saying things against mutual aid. But I think that we have different filter bubbles, because that's not what I see at all. I'm not saying that there aren't people who are critiquing it. Fuck, I've got critiques of mutual aid, especially just when it's just that it's basic. But I'm just saying, like,
oh yeah, I do too.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying, but I'm just not seeing the when you just were like, oh man, people just unloaded on this stuff. I don't see that, because I see a different. My internet filter bubbles are different, you know. So it's, I think it's always important to be able to backtrack and go like, what view is this coming from, or where is it, you know. I mean, actually, fucking Chomsky's the one who got me to think about him and Edward Herman, you know, back fucking in the 90s.
Yeah, manufacturing consent.
Manufacturing consent. I mean, like, that's the first thing where I started to actually think about critical thinking. And it's much harder to do it with media now, you know, because the way that the platforms work, you know, with corporate social media.
Algorithms, things that are giving you exactly what you want to see.
But also comes from your friend, you know, like if your friend posts it, maybe they didn't really critique it, they just posted it, and then now you have this built-in assumption it came from a friend, so it has some legitimacy to it that it might not have had at all. You might have not even fucking looked at it had you seen it somewhere else on CNN or something that day or something. Does that make sense?
100%.
I mean, and they want to use that to sell stuff. You know, they want to sell those things. You know, sell products and stuff. And so that's why those things work. So I want to be careful about, you know, like, not sources and stuff. And you know, like I work with agents. You know, I work with agency with anarchist PR. Right. It's a public relations firm. And so our thing isn't about trying to just fix the media, but to inject and use it as a site of struggle, as a place to to express ideas outside of the right or left paradigms and outside of electoral politics paradigms around these issues. The other thing is to, because there is power in the media, if we worked it harder, not just an agency, but leftists, when I do it, I can transform the fucking narrative. I can see it. I can, what they call controlling the narrative. We can control the narrative, but we just don't, because so many activists and people in those subcultures don't see the value in it and controlling the narrative. They want to, you know, if they use corporate media or mainstream media, they do it for the action that they have, or the one campaign interview that they're going to do, but they don't use it to go like, I'm going to be on all of those media outlets and I'm going to fucking control, I'm going to turn the narrative around completely. That's a different way to look at, which is what right wingers do. And that's what agency also tries to do, but just to a limit, much more limited degree. I'm going to give an example. Talk about mutual aid. That is a narrative control, like a huge sphere of influence, if you want to use less negative terms, because during the pandemic, we could just be talking about, I don't want to compare different things, but we could be only talk about electoral politics and how governments can save us. Or we could only talk about how within anarchist circles, we must, how insurrection is the only answer. Or we could talk about, there's a myriad of things, you understand what I'm saying, but what is the dominant conversation? That's not an accident. I'm not kidding. It's not an accident. Like, that happened because it's been generated consciously for the last few years. And it makes sense. I mean, goddammit, it's common sense, but mutual aid specifically. But they call it optics on the right. You know about that, right? Like, of course. Just pick a thing and you just run with a story. Yeah. But we just don't use it on the left for some reason. We're just like, can't trust the New York Times, so I'm not gonna fucking ever talk to them. So the New York Times doesn't post they just post what they think is the version of the story.
Yeah, and I think that, so often when you're entrenched in, community organizing milieus, like, what ends up happening is people are like, yeah, I don't want to talk to the press. I don't want to talk to the media. I don't want to talk to the press. You know, and God knows I've said it myself plenty of times. But I think that you're onto something here. There is something to be said for being able to tactfully and strategically propagate a narrative that is true, that points to the good work that we're doing, and in many ways allows us to set the terms and conditions for how that story is told. And I definitely think you're right. It's weird.
There's great power in it.
There is power in it, and it's weird to say that, like, there's a lot we could learn from, like, the Alex Jones types, just thinking about it. not telling lies, to make the revolution happen, but, like, by engendering our shared stories, the stories that we are all enmeshed in, and owning the conditions of how they are told in a way that allows us to steer these overarching conversations towards more emancipatory aims.
That's the same. And this podcast is one of those. You do two things. You work the corporate media with a consciousness, not just one fucking interview, but all the interviews. You're like, we're going to do 15 of these motherfuckers because we're going to dominate the narrative. And then the second thing is you tell your own stories. And this came out of Common Ground too, the organization I co-founded. I mean, that was one of the major media coups that we were able to do, is we started we just started to tell our own stories as well as to engender the corporate media to do it, So we were able to in many ways to control the narrative at the time, and lost it much later. We lost control of the narrative. So once the fucking FBI shit came out and everything, but that's a whole different story.
Yeah, that's a story for another time.
That was a whole other set of fights. That's a whole other set of fights, though, right? And the fact that we are able to talk about mutual aid now has been a long process of not just people engaging in it, but me and others who engaged in this liberatory mutual aid after Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans began, just kept telling these narratives And then by the time things like Occupy began to come around and Occupy Sandy and all the different things, mutual aid became within anarchist subcultures, within activist subcultures, and then now within even mainstream cultures, a set of words and ideas that we're talking about, even though there's a huge spectrum within the ideas of mutual aid. And most people are talking about just watered down cooperation, which is perfect at the minimum, but I'm talking about liberatory mutual aid. But the fact that we're having that conversation, we're not having one about insurrection or, you know, some other variant at this moment.
It's funny, like, having conversations like these, because so often what ends up happening is, like, I have an idea for what I want to ask people about, and then it totally veers off in a different direction, and I always love when that happens because it's so exciting. But I had originally, like, thought about titling this episode Tilting at Windmills, and that phrase comes from Don Quixote and this idea that, yeah, you know, the old Don Quixote got on his horse and charged at windmills thinking that they were giants, right? Seeing these imaginary enemies everywhere. And in many ways, that's kind of what we've been talking about, right? Like seeing exacerbated imaginary enemies. And I think that it's really important for us to soberly and critically assess who our real material enemies are, and the structures and the systems and the institutions that engender so much immiseration and oppression and injustice in our lives. And I'm kind of wondering, you know, is the response to just tell our stories? And if so, what does that look like? And how do we do that in a way that allows us to champion an alternative vision of what the future could be by building it and prefiguring it right now?
What I would say is that everything that we think we know is wrong. And if we... And that doesn't make us bad people or that we are wrong, but it gives us, for me, an opening to go, well, what are the other ways I want to engage in that? And so, again, I would start to approach these ideas. I start to approach the practical engagement of ideas built on a liberatory set of foundations. And they're pretty much the same across, if I'm talking about in my limited, and you understand, I mean, I'm not an academic. I'm not a great thinker. I'm Soul called me a street philosopher one time. That's yeah, kind of probably what I am. That's about the level I'm at. You know what I mean? I'm like, I'll take it. You know, like I don't use fancy words and stuff because I like things to be very, very simple, even if they're complex, because so we can all understand them. Richard Feynman is the one who said that, like, be able to explain it to a third grader. So I always think about that. And I think it's important, but I've recognized that I've been wrong so many times in doing this stuff that I want to make that a liberatory set of principles. So whether I'm talking about guns, mutual aid, decentralized disaster relief, surveillance, or anything, I want to approach it from these basic ideas, these liberatory set of ideas. One is to lead by asking, like the Zapatistas say, lead by obeying. But I would say lead by asking, and that's curiosity. So if you're, you know, whether asking yourself, asking those around you, asking the communities to which you may want to engage in, ask first. And start there. Two, recognize that you don't have the answers. You don't have any. You might have some specific special information about something, but that you are coming at this in solidarity, not in charity from somebody. So solidarity being that I have something to gain from this, not just helping them, but that our lives are intertwined together. The third one is dual power. I would also say that dual power, not in a communist, old school communist sense, but an anarchist interpretation of that, which is to resist and rebel on one hand, which is what political and social movements and activist subcultures have done in the United States forever. And that is a necessary component. I'm not saying we should ever make it go away, because oppression and needs to be challenged and stopped and mitigated. We need to alleviate suffering as we can, but it's not the only way to approach it. You must approach it by creating and building. And I don't mean just creating campaigns. Maybe that's a start, but how do you want to build for the future? Knowing the fourth one, that you're going to be wrong, that there's going to be unintended outcomes, consequences, and impacts in it, and you cannot mitigate them, but you still want to move forward. So, And then I think the other one is direct action, and then autonomy and collective liberation. I think these are all these ideas together create a liberatory framing that I think that you can carry to other stuff over and over again. Everything, if you approach it with some of these basic framing ideas, you can plant gardens of any kind anywhere that you want. And then if there's 10, you know, liberatory ideas or principles or foundations to start from, they're not canonized. It's not anarchism. It's anarchy. These are sets of ideas to guidepost us to where we want to go, or where we are to build where we're going as we go. And some of it's going to be prefigurative. Some of it's going to blow up in our face. Some of it is never going to happen. But many things will be built along the way with no resources, or little resources, time, money, and people. And I think that I said this before, but I think all the forms of disaster will make this much more relevant as we go. And even though anarchists put fancy words on things like mutual aid instead of cooperation, solidarity, you know, and over charity, you know, like, really, it's just taking care of each other like you would normally do. And I would say get rid of the, keep a political analysis, because that's important, but don't let it be the overarching thing. Because your identity as whatever political identity or social identity or ethnic identity is only part of who you are in all of this. And so recognize that it's not the most important thing. Actually trying to survive or alleviate suffering or to stop oppression or to create something beautiful from our desires is far more important than whether you call yourself a goddamn anarchist, a socialist, or whatever the thing, whatever it is, or whatever you think that you are. You know, I mean, Aragorn and I, Aragorn Bang from, you know, who used to run Anarchist News and a few other, you know, Little Black Card. I mean, he really is the one who helped me really hone in on the focus of that. And I give him full credit for that, of like anarchy, not anarchism. And I know that there was other post-left people who wrote that before, but it really began to make sense about 10 years ago, you know, within my anarchist struggles and my own deepening analysis and you know, perspectives and reflections on stuff. So I think the liberatory foundations I mentioned before, you, like I said, you can grow a garden anywhere. And I use this another silly analogy, is that a forest from outer space looks the same anywhere, to pretty much, right? It's like trees and flora and fauna, right? But if you look at a forest in Jakarta, or you look at one on the east coast of the United States or somewhere else, they're totally different. The trees are different. The flora is different. The fauna is different. But they all have the similar makeup to them. So why couldn't we approach liberatory foundations in a similar way? I mean, if you want to call it green anarchy, you can. But that, you know, like, but I'm just saying, like, that's where I kind of come from with this stuff. And the foundations, again, it's very, very important to recognize they are just guideposts. They are just pointers. They do not define what you do, and they do not rigidify what you do. When you begin to rigidify things and make them into isms, then you have already lost. It's not anarchy anymore. It's just another fucking ideology. And so I think for political people, bust out of the ideologies, but maintain a serious set of ethics, and listen to yourself and those around you, because anarchy at its root, for me and for those, is making decisions with those around you that you trust, because that we know our lives better than anybody else. I didn't make that shit up. I mean, that's just my interpretation of it, you know?
100%. Well, there's a lot of wisdom there, and I think it's a beautiful note to kind of end the conversation on. Scott, thank you seriously so much for coming on Coffee with Comrades. I know it's been a long time coming, so I'm glad we could finally link up and make it happen.
Oh, me too. Really.
I know you wanted to leave sort of the limelight, but I do also want, you know, if you want to plug anything, if you want to talk about, you know, your art gallery or the record label or anything like that, or agency and the great work that y'all are doing there.
You know, like, even though I've left activist subcultures and stuff, I'm still want to alleviate suffering and still do things. And so I'm still engaged in projects. I also have to live, so I have to work. So I've just melded art and culture, which I value and have incredible value. And I wish political subcultures had much more. I wish they valued culture much more and recognized the importance of how culture shapes things much more than policy or laws. But so in that, I started a record label called emergencyhearts.com. And it's a mostly electronic label of vintage and new stuff. I'm recording new music also, using it as another way to express stories and stuff. I'm still I took a hiatus from writing books. I've got like 6 books in the works in various degrees. I've been working for some of them for 8 or 9 years and some of them 2 or 3 years. And so I just took a break and decided to start this label. And like for now, the label emergencyhearts.com, we've been giving away all the titles of the whole catalog. And we have like, I think like 60 titles right now for free because, you know, it's been a pandemic. And then we had 2 titles that we were selling and 100% of the proceeds after Bandcamp takes them would their fee goes to supporting Austin musicians here called Ham. They have it's a local insurance cooperative and it just helps musicians in Austin, Texas. And then that's an album I did with a guy named Televangel, and it's called Anthropocene Blues Revisited.
Again, what a great title. Pitch for that.
Oh my God. It was supposed to be out in January, but it didn't come out until right during the pandemic. It just kind of happened. So there'll be a video coming. There'll be some videos coming.
It's weird how the universe has that kind of timing, right?
Oh my gosh. Totally. Totally. And, so emergencyhearts.com, you can go there. You can, and if you go to, and then it'll take you to Bandcamp and you can download all the music for free if you want. But if you want to buy the tracks, you can buy them. All the money is getting given away for now. And like I said, there's like 60 different, releases on there. The other thing is I still have my website. I don't post on it that much. I still put up new media interviews occasionally. But it's scottcrow.org, scottcrow.org. I have a lot of writings. I've hundreds of interviews on there, going back, you know, since 1985, probably. But there's a lot of writings on there, and I'm working, and then I work with agency.org, and we are an anarchist PR firm, ostensibly. We try to place stories within corporate media or give anarchist voices in corporate media, alternative views that aren't just about electoral politics or right versus left, as I mentioned before. We also try to have a sphere of influence across a lot of narratives. The other thing that we do is we also share anarchist generated media. People, you know, like Coffee with Comrades gets shared occasionally and things like that. I don't know what the criteria is for that. And, you know, an agency, I think, is got a valuable place. And if you look at media and corporate media as a site of struggle, but also a place to control the narrative or have an incredible sphere of influence in the narrative, because shifting culture is as important as any particular legislative change or anything. And shifting culture happens far before any laws become effect, and it can alleviate suffering. So I've got that thing, agency, and then I run a small art gallery and consulting business. The art gallery we had to close last year, and this is my 3rd gallery, Century Modern. But we work with artists in New Mexico and Texas, and we place their artwork privately, do consulting and stuff like that. It's not super highbrow anymore. It used to be, but now it's just like we just sell things that we like. So I've been doing that for a long time, and so that's kind of it. And I support in Texas a lot La Frontera Fund, which provides abortion access for women in Texas, because we went from 33 women's health care centers to 3 in a state
Christ.
Of almost 20 million people. And it's a huge state. There's a lot of land. So these women teach women how to take care of each other. They deal with the most marginalized women. But La Frontera Fund, I would totally look into them. And I work to support them a lot, you know, like verbally, but also materially. We support them. And they're not fucking Planned Parenthood. Money goes to, helping migrant women directly on the border that need it. They need whole women's health in all different forms, as well as just underserved people. And so often, if it's abortion, the Frontera Fund will pay for the hotel stay or the transportation or both of those. And then Lilith Fund will pay for the actual operation. So that's what Frontera Fund is, a women run collective that I super support. It's mostly women of color.
Beautiful. Hell yeah. Well, Scott, this is great. I appreciate you, man. Thank you so much, man. It's been a real treat.
It's been great. Thank you so much for doing this podcast and for, I'm so glad, like you said, too, I'm really glad that we got to connect and got to talk about some of these things. And actually, you opened up a lot of cans that I have not talked about in a long time or thought about that. I appreciate that. It was really a thoughtful conversation. I appreciate it. Thanks for the opportunity.
And that about does it for this week's episode of Coffee with Comrades. This is an entirely DIY show run by workers for workers. If you like what you hear, you can follow us on Twitter at CoffeeWComrades and Instagram at CoffeeWithComrades. Check out our website, www.coffeewithcomrades.com, and sign up to support our work with a monthly contribution by going to www.patreon.com/coffeewithcomrades. You can find Coffee with Comrades on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play, wherever you go to get your anti-capitalist propaganda. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. While you're there smashing that subscribe button, be sure to rate and review the show as well to help us increase our reach. If you have feedback, criticism, or you'd just like to get in touch with us, shoot us an email at coffeewithcomrades@gmail.com. Until next time, stay wild out there, comrades.